Thank you, Dominique, for inviting me here and also being so generous to actually give me a bit of time from your own talk. So I will be talking about information geometry and local asymptotic normality in quantum statistics. So what is quantum statistics? This is not an official mathematical classification, but it's a subfield of, say, quantum information science that deals with statistical inference problems that arise in quantum technology and quantum information. Okay, so how to understand measurement data from measuring quantum systems when you try to build some quantum devices, or you try to measure parameters like in the gravitational wave detector LIGO that has recently detected gravitational waves. So that's quantum statistics. So this field is kind of new, but actually it started already in the 70s. So some of the pioneers were Holevo and Belavkin in Russia, and Hellstrom in United States. So already from the beginning, they started to think about how to estimate quantum states, and are there some intrinsically quantum notions like Fisher information on the level of quantum states as a sort of generalization of probability distribution. Okay. At that moment, it was quite theoretical. There were no experiments looking at individual quantum systems and measuring them and estimating their state and so on. But nowadays, it's an important problem in actual experiments in quantum technology. So people more and more in experiments use data analysis, statistical analysis, in order to make draw conclusions about what they are creating in the experiments, like some special nice entangled state of many ions. Okay, so I came to this field through Richard Gill, who is a statistician, and he was one of the few statisticians so who came from the statistics side, rather from the physics side, to this field, and he suggested to me to work on this notion of local asymptotic normality because it's an important notion in statistics, and well, he thought that there should be a quantum analog to this. So this has remained one of my main research topics, and through several stages we have looked at this in the case of independence or ensembles of independent quantum systems. And then now we move to Markov processes, quantum Markov processes, or correlated states. Okay, and doing this, when you look at multiple parameters, you come across this notion of information geometry, which is basically the metric, the Fisher metric on the space of parameters. And that's when I became interested to come to this conference, because it's an important topic here. Okay, so what's the plan? So I just want to talk a bit about classical statistics, just to show some notions that we'll try to generalize in the quantum case, yeah, like Fisher information and asymptotic normality. Then I will tell you what is quantum estimation. First, I will quickly review what Carol has presented before, the basic notions, and then what is quantum Fisher information, and how do we estimate quantum states when you have ensembles of identically prepared states. And the last part will be looking at input-output systems. So this is a formalism that exists in engineering, in control engineering, but also in quantum physics. And from the probabilistic point of view, essentially we are looking at Markov processes or hidden Markov processes in the quantum context. And we want to estimate the parameters of these processes. Okay, so very basic stuff. Everybody knows it, but so in statistics, we always start with a statistical model. So it's a family of probability distributions indexed by some parameter theta. And this is unknown. And we get a sample from this distribution, or many samples. And we want to estimate theta. That's the problem. Yeah, these two examples are kind of the most basic ones. So coin toss, if you have a coin with which is biased, so it has a probability of heads theta and tails 1 minus theta. If you toss it n times and they are all independent, then you get this probability of a particular sequence. And yeah, you can estimate the probability. And the other kind of basic model is Gaussian shift, where you have Gaussian distribution with unknown mean and fixed and known variance. So you want to estimate the mean. Okay, why I give these examples? Because later on we will discuss about the quantum analogs of this. And also, when n goes to infinity here, so when n is large, this kind of model actually is approximated by a simple Gaussian shift model. And that's the meaning of this asymptotic normality. Okay, so these are the models, and typically the problem could be like estimation. So you want to, from the data, construct an estimator, so a function from the data space into the parameter space, such that the distance between the estimator and the true parameter is small in expectation. So that's the risk. Okay? But there are many other statistical problems, of course, and actually, I would be more interested in understanding not how to solve a particular estimation problem, but how to understand the structure of a statistical model in some limit, maybe when it gets easier to understand. Okay, so the basic tool here, as everybody knows, is the Kramer-Rao inequality. So if you take an unbiased estimator, whose mean is equal to the parameter, then the covariance of this unbiased estimator cannot be arbitrarily small. So the covariance is always larger than the inverse of the Fisher information of that statistical model. And the Fisher information can be computed with this formula. Okay, so that's the Kramer-Rao bound. It's an inequality, so okay, why is it so important? It might be achieved with some special models and is in general not achieved. However, it is asymptotically attained. Yeah, and that's why Fisher information is important, because actually when you have many samples from your data, you do achieve this Kramer-Rao bound. And one generic estimator that does that is the maximum likelihood estimator. So if you have n IID data from your distribution P theta, the maximum likelihood is the value of the parameter theta for which the likelihood, the probability of seeing that data is maximum. So you maximize over all parameters. So that's the estimator. And this estimator satisfies the Kramer-Rao inequality. So it saturates it in the sense that if you look at the difference between the estimator and the true parameter, this will go down to zero as n goes to infinity. So if you rescale it with the convergence rate, which is square root of n, this quantity will become asymptotically normally distributed, and the covariance is exactly the Fisher information. Yeah. So in that sense, we have here equality, only that this will be n times smaller when you have n data. Okay. So a consequence of this is that n times the covariance of the estimator converges to the inverse of the Fisher information. So in that sense, the Kramer-Rao bound is achieved. Okay, now the problem is, this is very nice in classical statistics, but in quantum statistics, as we will see later, we don't have a notion of likelihood. So many things are problematic when you go from classical to quantum. So I don't have maximum likelihood, for example. There is no obvious way to define it. So I would like to have something, some tool from classical statistics that can be translated into quantum statistics, which has to do with this Fisher information, which is fundamental there. Okay, so that's the notion of local asymptotic normality. And I would like to explain it on the example of the coin toss, which is the simplest possible model. So again, we have n coins with probability theta and 1 minus theta. So of course, the best thing to do is just to take the number of heads, divide by n, and that's your estimator of theta. And that is also a sufficient statistic, so if you only look at the total number of heads, you don't lose any information about your data. And also because you add up independent variables, there is a central limit theorem, so this estimator, if you take out, if you subtract the mean, renormalized by square root of n, again, this converges to, so it's normally distributed with mean zero and variance theta times one minus theta. Okay, so this is shown here for probability 0.6. So this is the distribution of theta hat. Okay, this is just central limit theorem, but I would like to know how this data, so now this is basically my data, instead of having different zeros and ones, I just put them together in total number of heads, and this is my data, so how does this behave when I change the parameter theta? So if I throw a coin with theta 0.5, I get this distribution for the maximum likelihood for the theta hat, and this is with 0.4, and this is with 0.3. So what you see is that actually for quite a large range of parameters, the binomial distribution, so the blue line, which is the binomial distribution of theta hat, follows a Gaussian with the appropriate mean, but the fixed variance, so I'm not changing the variance at all. And that approximation works well. So it's a Gaussian shift, I just change the mean and don't change the variance. And this goes wrong if you go too far away, so now you see that the variance of theta hat is actually different from the variance, that fixed variance that I choose for the Gaussian. Okay, so what's happening here? Basically what this says is that, okay, I'm going to change the parameters, so write theta instead of, as a perturbation of some fixed theta zero with a small parameter of the order 1 over square root of n. So I'm going to write it as theta 0 plus u over square root of n. Okay, this is just a rewriting of the parameter, and now my unknown parameter is u instead of theta. And I imagine that u is this deviation here, changing theta by something of the order 1 over square root of n. And now instead of estimating theta, I estimate u hat n. So from theta hat, you can write a u hat, which is this. And again, you write the central limit theorem, and you'll find, with a little argument, that the distribution of this local parameter u is normal with mean u, and variance equal to theta 0 times 1 minus theta 0. So the variance in the first approximation is fixed. It only depends on this theta 0, while originally we had this variance which changed with theta as well. Yeah. So this is a much simpler model because you have unknown parameters only in the mean of the Gaussian and not in the variance as well. And this is called asymptotic normality. So let me just summarize. So I transform data to the theta hat, which was the frequency of heads, and then I kind of rescaled it and I got this u hat. So this is still my data, this is still my statistical model, and this has a distribution which is simply a Gaussian shift. So it has a mean u and a fixed variance related to the center of my local ball where I do this approximation. Okay?
Sorry.
Yes?
Is that also a consequence of the central limit theorem?
Okay, so that's a good question. So what I kept saying central limit theorem, so what's the relation between this and central limit theorem? So it's very closely related, but in the next slide I will give a precise definition of asymptotic normality. And there you will see that it's not exactly the central limit theorem, but it is closely related to it. Yeah?
Because its variations are given on a different scale, because they depend on n, so.
Yes.
It will be different.
Okay, so one obvious difference is that in the central limit theorem, theta is fixed. Here I'm interested in what happens when I vary theta and I look at my data. Yeah, so how the distribution of the data varies. So actually it's a sort of uniform central limit theorem. Yeah. So it says not only for one particular value of parameters, but for a whole neighborhood around that point of size 1 over square root of n, the data looks Gaussian with fixed variance. Yeah? Okay, so that's a good point. So what is the general statement in statistics? So if I have n samples from some arbitrary probability distribution on some arbitrary space, under some regularity conditions on the dependence on the unknown parameter, I can approximate this model locally. So if I write my parameter as theta 0 plus u over square root of n, so imagine a manifold in the parameter space. I take a point and a little region around it of size 1 over square root of n, and I'm only looking at what happens there. This model will be approximated by a Gaussian model. So on the same parameter space, where the local parameter u becomes the mean, and the variance is simply the inverse Fisher information at the center of that region. Okay? In what sense this is approximated by this? That's where you see that there is a difference with the central limit theorem. So this is a concept introduced by a French statistician, Lucien Lecam. And the idea is that when are two statistical models similar or close to each other, if you can map the data from one model into data that looks very similar to data that you would have obtained in the other model. Yeah, so I take my n coin tosses, I do something with them, take a statistic of them, maybe add some noise, and I get something that looks like a Gaussian with mean u and variance I minus 1, without knowing what u is. Yeah? So what this means is that you do a randomization. So a randomization in a mathematical sense is that you have a map from the probability distributions in your n sample space into the probability distributions of the Gaussian model, which live on Rk, yeah? So k-dimensional parameter space. Yeah? So I have a randomization that goes this way, and I have a randomization that goes the other way, so I can also take a Gaussian, do something with it, and produce something that looks like n independent coin tosses with probability theta 0 plus u over square root of n. Okay, so I can do this in such a way that for large n you will not see the difference. So if I map my probability from the coin tosses through this randomization, and I take the difference with the density of the Gaussian, this is the density of the normal Gaussian with mean u, I take the norm 1 distance between them, so this is a strong distance, I can take supremum over this local parameter. And when n goes to infinity, this goes to 0. So they uniformly, they are close to each other. And also the other way around, I can do some randomization to the Gaussian and get coin tosses or whatever samples you want to have. OK, so this is a kind of abstract definition. But using this tool, you can actually derive error rates for estimating parameters in various statistical problems. It can be finite dimensional, but statisticians work often on infinite dimensional problems like density estimation and so on. And this kind of transformations to a Gaussian can be very useful because estimating means of Gaussian is much easier to understand than estimating some funny parameters, right? So it's a theoretical tool, but it has also some practical use. But for me, it's important because I know how to translate this in the quantum case. Yeah, so randomizations, as Carol explained, in the quantum case are transformations between states. And these are quantum channels, so that will be my notion of randomization. This would be states, so I will be mapping states close to states. There is a notion of norm 1 distance. So this definition can be translated immediately in the quantum setting, while the notion of maximum likelihood and likelihood is not obvious. Okay, so that's the end of my section on classical stuff. So if you have any questions, maybe ask now. Okay, so now I want to talk about quantum estimation. So let me just start with some motivation. So quantum estimation is, nowadays, it's a very important problem for quantum engineering. Yeah, so this is a picture from the lab of Reinhold Blatt in Innsbruck. So they work with ion traps. So somewhere inside here, between all these lasers and wires, there is a little cavity. And inside the cavity, there are atoms. So each of these dots is an ion. And they float there between some fields. And each of the ions can be thought of as a qubit, so a two-dimensional system that Carol explained. And altogether, they form a very large dimensional system of dimension 2 to the power the number of atoms. Okay? And this is a sort of prototype of a quantum computer. So each of these will be a qubit in the computer, and you need to do some transform. So a quantum computation will be a transformation on these qubits, unitary transformations. So we are not there yet, but in this sort of groundbreaking paper in 2005, they showed that they can prepare an interesting entangled state of 8 ions, which is something you should be able to do if you want to build a quantum computer. Yeah. So how do they do that? Well, they apply some field, some lasers, and they rotate these qubits in certain ways. Okay. But how do you know that you have actually done that? You can't just look at the atoms with your bare eye and see, oh, yes, I have succeeded. You need to actually measure them. And in quantum mechanics, measurements give random outcomes. So quantum mechanics is actually a statistical theory. It's not a deterministic theory. And from those random outcomes, you need to actually infer, using statistical techniques, what was the state that you have created. Yeah? So this experiment has two parts. One is the creation of the state, which is hard. And then there is the statistical part. You just take all this huge amount of data, and you analyze it, and you need to see whether you created something close to what you wanted. Okay? So why is it difficult? Already with 8 ions, you have a density matrix of dimension 2 to the 8 by 2 to the 8. So there are 4 to the 8 minus 1 parameters, 65,000. You need to do many measurements, so each ion is measured in 3 different directions. So this is the number of measurements. It takes a long time for an experimentalist. You have to keep repeating these measurements many, many times. And it took them weeks of or something of computer time to compute the estimator and error bars. Okay, so this is a motivating problem for working in this field. And we have done some work as well. I'm not going to talk about this problem, but just keep in mind what quantum statistics is about from the practical point of view. Okay. Right, so now just a quick reminder, what are these states? So you have a Hilbert space, and a state is just a matrix in that, so an operator in that Hilbert space. So if it's finite dimensional, it's a finite dimensional matrix, which is positive and has trace 1. They form a convex set, and the extremals are these one-dimensional projections onto lines in that Hilbert space. And these are also called pure states, and mixed states, so general density matrices, are convex combinations of these pure states. Okay, if you take the linear span of, so these are positive. So if you take the linear span, you get the so-called trace class operators, which are the analog of L1 space of the linear span of probability densities. Yeah. So why this is an analog of probability density or probability distribution? Because if you look on the diagonal of the rho of the state, it's just a probability distribution on d points. No matter which basis you choose. Yeah? And this will be just the probabilities of obtaining, when you measure in that basis, of obtaining various outcomes, as you will see in the next slide. There are lots of parallels with classical probability. So all these distances that we use in classical probability, like two distance or one distance or L infinity distance, the Hellinger distance have quantum analogs. Okay. Right. So as I said, so these are the states, but these states cannot be seen with bare eye. You need to do a measurement. So what is a measurement? You need to choose what you are measuring. So the easiest way to think of it is just take an orthonormal basis in that Hilbert space. Yeah. And what you get as an outcome in that measurement will be the index of that base. So you'll get one of these vectors in the basis. And the probability is just given by the diagonal element of your density matrix in that basis. Okay? So that's how you learn about the state. You learn the diagonal by measuring in that basis many times, and then you do another measurement in a different basis, and you learn about a different diagonal. And so you look at the state from different angles, and you want to then put together all this information in an estimator. If you want to think of measurements in a more abstract way, you don't need to project onto a particular basis. So more generally, you can do measurements which have outcomes in arbitrary measure spaces, and always the property is that the probability of obtaining some particular the probability of a particular event A is given by trace rho with some positive operator M of A. So each event is attached to a positive operator. And these positive operators, they all together, they are called positive operator valued measure. They need to satisfy some properties. So they are positive, and they also have to add up to identity so that what you get here is an actual probability distribution. Yeah? And if you think of it like that, then a measurement is just a map from states. So this was the trace class operators here into probability densities of your measurement outcomes. So this map from rho to p rho, you can take the Radon-Nikodym derivative of this p rho with some dominating measure, and this map is a measurement. So it looks like these maps from L1 to L1 that I talked before, they are randomizations. So this is now a randomization from quantum to classical. That's a measurement. It's like a randomization. Okay? I will not give the definition of quantum to quantum randomization. So what does it mean? I want to transform states into other states according to the rules of quantum mechanics, and that's a quantum channel. Okay, so there is a notion of randomization on the quantum level. Okay, so we have the basic ingredients of states and measurements. So what are these statistical problems? So quantum parameter estimation, in general, you can think of it like this. So I have some sample from a state. So I have a quantum system prepared in a state rho, which depends on theta. So I don't know exactly what is the state. It has some unknown parameter. I want to do a measurement, and the measurement will give me some random outcome, and I know what's the probability distribution because I know what I'm measuring, but I don't know theta because I don't know the state. Okay? So from this measurement outcome, I want to estimate theta. Well, that's a quantum estimation problem. So like in the classical case, we have a quantum model, and we end up with an estimator. Okay, what is quantum about this? If you fix the measurement, here you just get some data, and this is a classical statistical model, and I deal with a classical problem, so anybody working in statistics can look at this problem and try to solve it. And this tomography problem that I talked about before is of that type. So they have some fixed measurements, and they get data, and they want to estimate theta. What is special about it is that this model is specific to quantum mechanics, so probabilities are of the form trace rho with something. Yeah.
So yeah. In that tomography example, theta, the entries of this big matrix, is it as simple as that? Theta.
Yes, exactly. So when you do tomography, you assume that you don't know anything about the state, so the full density matrix is unknown. So theta is just all the matrix elements of the state. Yeah. But it doesn't need to be like that. So I can also imagine a problem where I start with a state, I let it evolve with some unitary for some unknown time, and then I want to know what was the time that elapsed. So then I get a one-dimensional problem. Yeah. So I only look at a one-dimensional curve in my state of space, space of states. Okay, so that's kind of classical. However, in principle, you can optimize over these measurements. So there are many different measurements that you can use to probe the quantum state. The quantum state is some sort of data that you choose how to look at. Yeah? And once you have chosen how to look at, you have destroyed the quantumness of that data. You can't okay, now I'm going to look with a different measurement at the same sample. No, so you can look with only one single measurement, but you can choose it. So that's a specific sort of quantum feature, and this leads to the problem of optimal estimation. So what is the best measurement? Okay, but then you can go even further. So how did this theta end up encoded in that state? So very often you have a quantum system and it's prepared in some known state, but then there is some outside influence, like if you want to use it as a detector of gravity or of magnetic fields, this outside parameter changes the state. So the unknown parameter gets imprinted into this quantum state, and then you do the measurement and you want to learn the parameter. Okay? So, but now the question is, which state should I prepare in the first place in order to imprint this parameter with highest possible information imprinted in that state? Yeah? So that's a question of preparation of the initial state. And that's the, you know, kind of the main topic of quantum metrology. So people have discovered that some special entangled states give rise to much higher Fisher information, so lower error rates than typical product states, independent systems. Okay, I will not talk about metrology, but just for you to know. So if you want to estimate a qubit, like we saw before, this is basically, you know, the geometry is that of a sphere, and the qubit state is like a vector, three-dimensional vector, and the three parameters are written there.
It's a ball already. It's a mixed state. So it's a
ball. I mean ball. Yeah, yes.
Ball,
yeah. Yes.
It's a full ball. No.
It's the tennis ball. Yeah. So the sphere is the surface of the ball, and those are the pure states. Everything inside is mixed state. Okay, so if I give you a sample from this state, what do you do? Well, you can measure in various orthogonal bases, and these are called spin measurements. So if you measure along this axis or this axis or this axis, there are three different orthonormal bases corresponding to that, and the probabilities are equal to the projection. So if you project this vector on the z-axis, you get two segments, one to the top and one to the bottom, and those are the probabilities. So 1 plus minus are z over 2, and that's a coin toss. And if you do it with all three measurements, of course, you learn the three components, and then you know what the state is. Of course, that's in principle, but if you have a finite number of systems, you always get some error in this estimation. So that's this little red ball here is your uncertainty area when you estimate the state. And you see that already in this simple problem, you have some, there are some questions appearing here because parts of this red ball are outside of the Bloch sphere, so they are not really quantum states. They are negative matrices, right? Or actually, am I right? They are negative, yeah. So there are some interesting problems, and this is only for one qubit. Now, when you put together 8 of these qubits or more, the space of states becomes very large. As Carol said, we don't really understand the geometry of states that are a bit mixed, so they might have some positive eigenvalues, but many zeros, so the boundary of the space of states, and that's very important for these kind of problems. It's still kind of, there isn't a satisfactory answer to what is a good estimator when your state is close to the boundary. And that's important because in experiments, experimentalists are not interested in preparing a very mixed state because that's very noisy. They are interested in preparing a very pure state which is close to the boundary.
Or as the boundary.
On the bound, yeah, yeah. Okay, anyway, again, that's not really the topic. So the other example, so that was the qubit, so like the coin toss, and now the Gaussian. So in the quantum case, Gaussians kind of come in two-dimensional blocks. So the simplest quantum Gaussian, you can think of a two-dimensional Gaussian, okay, in the plane. And the two variables are not classical variables, but they are non-commuting operators. So Q and P, they have this commutation relation, so you can represent them as operators, observables on a Hilbert space. Okay, but the states of this kind of system are still what I said before, so density matrices. And some particular state is called the vacuum state. And it can be characterized if you look, so this is the characteristic function, just like in the classical case, characteristic function is the expectation of exponential of your minus I u x minus I v y. Yeah? So this is the characteristic function of my state, which is the vector 0. And it's a Gaussian. So characteristic function of a Gaussian is Gaussian. So that's the definition of the vacuum state. It's a Gaussian state which has mean 0 and variance 1/2. So it sits here. And as Carol said, if you apply this unitary operator to the vacuum, it will just shift the mean of that state. So you'll get a Gaussian state which has mean u and v, but the same variance. So this is my quantum Gaussian shift experiment or model. Okay. So if I now ask, I'm given a state, I know these are called coherent states, they are pure states, but I don't know the mean. So how do I estimate the mean? Okay. So what happens? If suppose I only I know that one of the means is 0, so I only translate along this axis. So there is a single parameter to estimate. You would guess immediately that you need to measure q, because that's what changes when you shift the state, the mean of q changes. And that's true. And when you measure q, you get a Gaussian with mean u and variance 1/2, because that's the variance of the quantum variables q and p. OK, so that's nice, 1/2. Now, what if I have both means are unknown? Well, classically, you would say, well, you look at q and you look at p, right? But quantumly, these two observables, they don't commute. You cannot measure them in the same time, because one of them has a certain sort of eigenbasis or set of eigenprojections, and the other one has a different set of eigenprojections, right? And they are, you can't put them together. You can't do this measurement in the same time. Instead, what you can do is sort of add some noise to q and add some noise to p. Okay, so there is an optimal solution to this, but it involves putting more noise into your variables. Okay, so at the end of that, what you will get is a Gaussian which has the right means, u and v, but the variance is not 1/2, it's 1. So that's 1/2 of noise has been added in order to make q and p commute. Yeah? I'm not going to explain the trick, but it's a simple thing. But the point is, in the quantum case, although you can estimate one parameter with a certain precision and another with a certain precision separately, I can't do both together with the same precision. Yeah? So this is a feature that is not present in the classical case. OK, so now I come to the quantum Fisher information. So back to our estimation problem. If I have a fixed measurement, we know Kramer-Rao bound says that the covariance of the estimator is larger than the inverse of the Fisher information. OK, so this is classical. But now if I vary measurements, I can try to lower this inverse Fisher information. So what's the lowest value of this inverse? Because that's the precision. Yeah? And then you end up with a quantity called quantum Fisher information. And that actually depends only on the quantum state. So the measurement has disappeared because I'm optimizing over it. Yeah? So this is the quantum Fisher information. So you can define it in a similar way to the classical Fisher information, or you can think of it in a different way. So the quantum Fisher information is the Riemannian metric corresponding to this Bures distance that we have discussed about before. So this is the distance on the space of states. And if you look at two points close to each other, two states that are close to each other, this distance is quadratic in your parameter theta. So you can write it as delta theta f delta theta. Yeah, so this is multi-parameter problem. Okay, so that's the metric on the space of states that corresponds to estimation, to Fisher information. Okay, so that's very nice, and that has been discovered a long time ago. And actually, it's very good for one-dimensional problems, like I explained before. This will tell you how well you can estimate one parameter, but it will not tell you how well you can estimate two parameters. It's in fact not achievable. So this inequality here is achievable, at least asymptotically, when you have many samples. This inequality will never be achievable because of the non-commutative nature of quantum mechanics. So it's a nice bound. It tells me something, at least for one parameter, it's the right thing to look at. But when you have multi-parameter problems, there is something missing, right? So the quantum Fisher information is not enough. I'll come to that in a moment. So let's look at the simplest possible model is you take a pure state, so a vector in the Hilbert space, and you rotate it with a unitary e to minus I theta g. So theta is the time that you rotate, and g is the generator.
Like
the Hamiltonian. So you just rotate the state. Okay. So this is a statistical model. What's the Fisher information of this? Well, it's essentially the speed of your rotation. So the length of the derivative of psi theta with theta squared, which is the same as the variance of the generator. So if the generator has bigger variance, it means that it sends the state further away, and so states get separated better, so the Fisher information is larger. Okay, so keep in mind, for very simple model, just pure states rotated, the Fisher information is the variance of the generator of that rotation. Okay, so now I want to understand, I want to extend this concept of asymptotic normality that we had in the classical case. So that said that when I had n samples from some distribution, and I look locally in my parameter space, that distribution of the n samples looks Gaussian. So what's the quantum analog? I'm going to take the simplest model where I have rotation of a vector with e to I theta g, and I take n samples of this. So this is tensor n, yeah? So tensor n times this vector. And I'm going to take the parameter to be theta zero again plus u over square root of n. So that means each of these vectors in my n samples is just rotated by a bit, yeah, by u over square root of n. But when I have n of them, the effect accumulates, right? So how does this work? So imagine you have now two of these vectors. So one has been rotated with parameter u, and the other has been rotated with parameter v. And these are just vectors in a Hilbert space. You can understand everything if you look at the inner products of the vectors, right? This is just geometry of the Hilbert space. So if I want to understand the geometry of this model where I rotate them by some angle of the size 1 over square root of n, right, then I only need to look at the inner products of the vectors. And this asymptotic normality just says the inner products of these vectors, when n goes to infinity, converge to the inner products of two Gaussian states, where the mean is essentially my parameter u here. So I have one with parameter u, one with parameter v. And also they have a constant in front, which is the Fisher information, because we said larger Fisher information means that the vectors get further apart. Okay? So this is very easy to see. So take the inner product of psi with parameter u and its tensor n, and psi with parameter v, tensor n. The inner product will be the inner product of the two vectors to the power n because they are independent. And now inside here, you get the difference of the local parameters. So because you rotate one of them with u and then the other with v, you'll get the difference between u and v divided by square root of n. And then you expand this in powers because you have 1 over square root of n. You can always take the generator to have expectation 0. It's a sort of choice of that doesn't matter. And then you end up with the second term, which is the variance of g divided by n. So it's 1 minus variance divided by n to the power n. This converges to this exponential. And the exponential is just happens to be, or well, it doesn't happen because it's asymptotic normality. It's equal to the inner product of these two coherent states that I, two Gaussian states. So the geometry of n spins is the same as the geometry of coherent states when n goes to infinity. Okay, that's asymptotic normality for pure states. So since I want to get to correlate these states, I will not go in lots of details, but this concept of asymptotic normality can be extended to mixed states of finite dimensional systems. So then it's not just a matter of taking inner products of vectors because they are mixed states, but you can still do it. And you can also extend it to infinite dimensional systems. Just quickly to say how you would do it in for qubits. So if you want to do it for qubits, you would take a little ball of size 1 over square root of n, let's say on the z-axis, with the center on the z-axis. So the center of the ball is the state mu, 1 minus mu, on the diagonal. And then how do you fill this ball? Well, you need to modify the eigenvalues by something of the order square root of n. So you go up and down on the diagonal, but that's a classical object. Yeah, I'm just changing, I'm looking at diagonal matrices with different probabilities here. So it's a coin toss. But I can also rotate the state. So when I rotate, I fill the ball completely. And the rotations are, it's a two-dimensional rotation group, and I need to use two generators, so sigma x and sigma y, so the rotation around the x and y axis with parameters u, x, and u. Ah, sorry, there should be a x and y here. Yeah. So there are three parameters to describe my little ball. One is moving along the eigenvalue axis, and two for rotations. So the corresponding limit Gaussian model will be, so this is not really surprising, or it's nice that it happens, is there is a classical Gaussian that comes from the fact that I'm just moving around this on this diagonal, so that's a classical coin toss. This is the limit model for the coin toss. And then there is a quantum Gaussian, which is the limit model for these rotation transformations. So the parameters completely separate in the limit. I get one classical model for one parameter and another quantum model for the rotation parameters. The Gaussian here is not the coherent state that I talked about. It's a state which has bigger variance, so it's a mixed state. But it's the same idea that you shift it, so the mean of this Gaussian state is linearly related to your rotation parameters, ux and uy, and it has a fixed variance. Yeah? So it's a simple thing to estimate. Okay. So the theorem is that there are channels that map my states, my n qubits with parameter, with these local parameters, into these classical quantum Gaussians and backwards uniformly over these local parameters, as long as the local parameters are not too large. Okay. Using this, you can solve the optimal estimation problem for qubits in the asymptotic setting, because you will say, I take my qubits, I map them through this quantum channel, these randomizations, they become Gaussian, and Gaussian is easy to estimate. Okay, so that's inspired by this work of Lecam. That's how we came to get around the problem of choosing measurements, because there is this problem of estimation, what is the optimal measurement, and you need to measure n systems. It's a huge space of possible measurements, but if you understand the structure of the model first, if you see that it's actually Gaussian, then you only need to think what's optimal for the Gaussian model. Yeah. Okay, so that's about IID ensembles. So systems which are prepared in the same state and you have many copies of them. So now I want to look at more interesting states where still I have like n systems, but the joint state is not a product. They have some correlations between them. So as motivation, this experiment has earned a Nobel Prize in Physics by Serge Haroche. This is an experiment where they try to prepare a particular quantum state inside the cavity. So this is light in the cavity by passing atoms through the cavity. The atoms interact with the cavity when they go through. And then they are measured when they come out. And then there is a feedback loop. So there is an action onto the cavity state depending on the measurement results of the atoms that have come out. Okay? So this is a quantum feedback experiment. So it's a quantum control. It's a quantum version of one of the basic tools in engineering that goes back to steam engines and everything. So most engineering systems have some feedback control inside in order to prevent it from blowing up. Yeah, so the if you look at the museum, you know, the science museum in London, you will see these steam engines, and they always have this governor. So that governor takes care that the pressure inside the boiler doesn't increase over some level. Yeah, and it's a feedback loop. This is a feedback loop with quantum systems. Yeah, so this is quantum control theory, this is a motivation for what I'm going to talk about. And the other motivation is LIGO. So in LIGO, they have detected gravitational waves. And this LIGO is essentially an input-output system. So they send light in some interferometer. One of the mirrors, both mirrors here, they can move. So when there is a gravitational wave, they change their position. And that influences the statistics of the light that comes out of the interferometer. Yeah, so it's a statistical problem, how to detect movement of these two mirrors in the light that comes out from the interferometer. Okay, so now more mathematically, you can think of the problems like this. So the next thing from IID is Markov. So how can you generate a Markov process or a Markov chain? You can think of a deterministic process where you have coins that kind of kick a system in a deterministic way. So if I have the position of the system at time n, xn, and there is a coin one yn coming, yeah, then the system will move to xn plus one. The coin will also change, so it's kind of perturbed by this interaction. And all this is deterministic, so there is a function of xn and yn that tells you how to do it. Okay, but the coins that come in are random, yeah, so they have a certain distribution. That's where the randomness comes in. And that makes, if you think about it, it makes that the system will perform a Markov walk on the space of states. Yeah? So I want to think of a Markov, this is not the usual way of thinking of Markov chains, but that's how you should think of it in quantum physics, as I will show you in a minute. And now what comes out here is a hidden Markov process. So this is a sort of process that tells you something about what happens inside the system. It's correlated with the system, and it's a hidden Markov process. Okay, so I'm going to call this output and this input, and in my context, I will be looking at this output and try to infer what happens inside. That's exactly my atom maser example of Haroche. There are quantum systems that come in, the atoms. They are prepared in some fixed state, like excited state. When they go in the cavity, they interact with my system through a fixed unitary. So there is a unitary happening on both of them. Then the atoms come out, and their state has been changed because of that interaction. So, and also they get correlated with each other because each one of them sees the system inside one after the other, so it has some memory about what happened before. So everything is described in this unitary, so system and atom, you apply the unitary, you can write it in a basis of the atom, you know, some orthonormal basis of the atom system, and you get these Ki operators, which are essentially the sort of representation of this unitary. And if you do this several times, sequentially, as the atoms come in, you get this kind of state where you apply these K operators one after the other with different indices, and these are the basis vectors of the atoms, and you take a sum of them, so linear superposition of all these vectors. And that's the state of system and atoms that come out. Okay, so this is called the matrix product state, and it's an analog of a state of a Markov chain. So the problem here is to estimate theta. So I suppose that I don't know what happens inside the cavity, what's this interaction, and I want to estimate theta by observing this kind of state of the atoms that come out. Okay, since time is kind of going, let me just show you one result, because we are talking about information geometry. So if you go to continuous time rather than discrete time, you'll have two parameters that are important, the Hamiltonian of the system and the coupling to the environment. So these are called H and L here. So these are operators on the system, so matrices. And now the problem is, I want to estimate this H and L by looking at the atoms that come out, so the output. Okay, so here is the state of the output. You just take the full state of system and the output, and you trace out the system. So that means you ignore this, you average over the system. And this state depends on this dynamical parameter. So you can just see something about the dynamics from the output. And one thing you can immediately see is that in the regime where time is very long, the system will go to some ergodic state, to some unique stationary state. And what comes out, the output is also stationary in time, okay? And then you see that if you transform the system parameters in this way, there will be no change of the output state. So if I rotate the Hamiltonian with a unitary, and I rotate the coupling parameters with the same unitary, and I can also add a constant to the Hamiltonian, so that just gives usually a phase, the state of the output will remain the same. Okay, that's something that you can easily check. So that means that in my space of parameters, I have these orbits of the action of this group. So this is an action of the projective unitary group and R, so from the constant here. So this action of this group produces some orbits in my parameter space, and on these orbits, I cannot see where I am, yeah? Because the output is the same for all the points on the orbits, okay? So the first theorem is about identifiability of this kind of problem, and we can prove that two parameters are equivalent, so they cannot be distinguished in the output, if and only if they are related by this group action. So what does it mean? It means that the identifiable parameters will be the quotient of the space of all parameters, so this space of H and L's, with the group action. And you can show that this is actually a manifold. Okay? And now that will be still a multi-parameter space, and then you need to think, what is the quantum Fischer information in this parameter space? You get something kind of complicated, but you can show that along these orbits, the Fischer information is zero, as you expect, because you don't see the difference. And there is a sort of a splitting of the tangent space into the tangent space along the orbits, so the non-identifiable parameters and the identifiable parameters, and this this plane of identifiable parameters, that's where you have a proper positive quantum Fischer information. Okay, so maybe I'll talk to you about it afterwards, just to say that there is a quantum Fischer information, and that's my information geometry, but there is also the same result that we had for IID case, so the local asymptotic normality holds as well in this context with correlated states and multi-parameters. And the simple Gaussian that we had for qubits becomes a multidimensional Gaussian with a certain commutation relations. Right, so to conclude, so asymptotic normality is an important concept in classical statistics, and we have established it for some different models in quantum statistics as well. The difference is that you get these non-commuting variables, the Gaussian, in the Gaussian limit. So the Fischer information is not the only concept that is important here. You also need to know the commutation relations of the limit model. Yeah. So there is lots of stuff that I haven't talked about. So we have looked at this relation with dynamical phase transitions and how to get very high precision, so-called Heisenberg limit. We have looked at linear systems, so it's a special class of systems that are very important in optics. There is an open problem about the quantum central limit theorem. So as I said, the question was about central limit theorem, so always underlying asymptotic normality, there is also some central limit theorem, and here we don't have it yet, but it's very important to derive it. I'm interested in how to use coherent feedback, so if you can change the configuration of your system in order to estimate the parameters better, so that's important for engineering, and also the design of the input states to get better precision. So this goes more in the direction of metrology. All right, so thank you for your attention.